Mr. C, WunderSTEM Hotline, how may I help you? Yes? Yes, I've been wondering the same thing. Absolutely, I know just the person. Yep, we'll put it online when we get it all figured out. Alright, thanks for calling. Bye! That was Penelope, and she had a question about engineers, specifically welding engineers. She was wondering, how does someone put together things like cars, or ships, or really big parts? Well, lucky for us, I know the perfect person, Jack from Yaskawa Motoman. He's a friend of mine, and he's a welding engineer. Let's go visit him and learn everything about welding.
My name is Jack Moore. I'm a welding engineer at Yaskawa Motoman, and we make industrial robots. They're very durable. They can go to the same point over and over and over within like less than a millimeter. They're very accurate, and it's all about doing the thing over and over and over and over and over. We can go to the same point every time. We can go through the same path every time. So they're industrialized. They can take fumes. They can take impacts. They can take all types of damage that caused by the process. I've got a bachelor's in science from Ohio State Welding Engineering Program. It's an engineering school, so you go through your normal math, science classes, chemistry, physics, and then when you get into the welding program, you learn about the weld processes. And then you get into metallurgy, which is essentially metal under a microscope. So that's one of my specializations. When you go into college, you can specialize in a certain few things, and I specialized in weld metallurgy as well as robotics. So it's typically, we're welding steel, we're welding aluminum, a little bit of stainless steel, a little bit of copper. All those materials have different physical behaviors that are different from each other. With welding in general, what we're trying to do is we're trying to melt two pieces of metal together. What we do is we pass typically some sort of electricity through it. When you pass electricity through metal, that heats up. If you pass a lot of electricity through, it heats up so much that it can turn from solid to liquid. So now we have two pieces of metal. This turns to liquid. This turns to liquid. That liquid mixes together into a common weld pool. And then we remove the heat source, we remove the electricity, and now that cools, it freezes, and now we have a solid structure. So when it comes to aluminum, that heat wants to flow everywhere. So it's hard to get the heat where you need it to be with aluminum. With steel, it's actually much easier to get the heat where you need it to be. So when you're dealing with like welding concepts and robotics, understanding the differences between aluminum and copper and other materials like steel and stainless steel, big difference is heat transfer and where the heat goes. There's two general categories of welding that we support. We have resistant spot welding, which is pretty common. The resistant spot welding, it's really difficult for a human to be able to do that process because the gun is really large, 100, 200 pounds. And we've got two electrodes that squeeze together. So we have two pieces of metal that we want to glue together, we want to weld together, and these electrodes come in and squeeze them together. And they pass enough welding current through these two electrodes to power a dozen houses. And we pass all the electricity through in less than 1 second. So all the electricity shoots through those two plates, right? And it melts it really quickly, and then it cools really quickly. And then you get a little bit of expulsion sometimes, some stuff that'll hit the ceiling and things like that. But overall, it's a very quiet, stable process. Humans can't drive that gun in space. So you need a robot for that. In contrast, arc welding, there's a lot of people that arc weld by hand. So you can go to a weld shop and people are welding, they're breathing in the fumes. It's a really hot environment. They've got leathers on. It's a really uncomfortable place for some people to be. And they weld all day long doing that. And our customers are having trouble finding people that want to do that these days. So they're coming to us saying that we need robots because we can't find people that want to weld. Over half of the robots that we sell traditionally over the 23 years I've been here are for welding. So we have robots that we use for picking up boxes, dispensing glue, painting, but most of the robots we sell are for welding. So to understand that process and to optimize the process is very important. Then we've got a customer that comes to us and says, we'd like to buy a robot from you. I've got these parts. So then I've got to understand the technology that we need to be able to stick those parts together and in the fashion that they require. So do we hang a sensor on the robot, which is like a vision system, like an eye for the robot? Do we develop like a finger for the robot so the robot can feel where the part is? And then once we get that understood, then we get into the weld process. Which welding equipment do we choose? Which welding wire, which shielding gas, things like that do we offer up to the customer to use? And then we validate that. So that's one of my roles is that I receive customer product. I've got to get the robot to weld perfectly their parts with only a handful of parts, right? And then they look at us and say, okay, that works. Sometimes there are parts that are really easy to weld, some are harder to weld. So then I take that information, and after the customer leaves, we get a team together and we say, well, we need to maybe improve our product so that we can do these applications better. Or maybe we need to improve like the eye of the robot or the finger of the robot so it can feel the part. And so I see customer applications, I'll sometimes visit customers, see their problems, and then I bring that knowledge back with us here, and then we develop our product. We continue to evolve our product for improvement.
Oh, so this is super cool. This looks totally different than the other robots. It's on a huge monster track. And I also noticed like this big, really big motor right here. What, tell me about this thing.
That's right. So we make small robots, medium-sized robots, and this is one of the bigger robots that we have. Most of our robots have six motors, six axes. So there's an axis here, axis here, axis here. You'll see three motors here. There's four, there's five, there's six. So there's your six motors for the robot. So you can see the robot doesn't have any feet. It doesn't have any wheels. So we add this seventh motor, and this is a track, so it allows the robot to slide up and down the track, increasing its range of motion.
So that's our industrial robot. That's the blue robot. So we typically don't have people work next to them. So Motoman, what we do is we'll actually design systems around the robot to keep people away from the robot so that people can't get injured by the robot. Now we have a white robot, and the white robot is a collaborative robot. And that robot allows us to take the walls down.
So I'm working close to the robot, and if I'd like the robot to stop, I can press on the robot, it'll stop, and then I can have it resume, continues on. So I can work next to it, I can interact with the parts. Robot, why don't you stop for a second? I'm gonna do something else. Robot, you can resume.
So now that people can get right next to the robot and they can interact with the robot. So maybe the robot's holding a part and then somebody comes in and touches the part, they do some work, they slide some things in, and then they walk away and the robot does more things. They can work together now. We get a Bear robot from our parent company in Japan. Bear robot, it's just a blue arm, nothing attached to it. So one of the things we do here as an integrator is not only do we wrap the robot into a safety system, but we attach tools to the robot. So it could be a gripper, it could be like a glue gun, could be a painting, you know, a paint sprayer, or it could be like a welding torch. And then an accessory to the welding torch might be a vision system, like an eye that we attach to the robot. Or maybe with that welding torch, we use the welding torch as a finger to touch the part. So we have to have, there's a whole software side to allow those tools to work. And that's the kind of the software development, the coding that I do. So just yesterday I was programming in the language of C. We all program robots here with that same language, right? So I'm a welding engineer, but I'm actually becoming a bit of a software guy. So that's the new language. Everyone's got to speak, I think, to some degree, that developer code. Everyone's got to have that, right? You learn English, you learn Spanish, you learn German, you learn French, you learn coding.
So this is a welding wire. This is what the welding current passes through. This is what melts and deposits into the weld joint to make a weld. So we melt this stuff. The problem is this, if we try to use this for a finger for touching, what happens when I touch the part? It bends. This is really soft. So once we touch it one time, now we gotta throw that wire away and we have to inch more wire out and cut it again. So what we're doing with this is rather than moving the robot until the wire touches and it bends, the wire is continuously doing this. It touches and it frees itself, touches and frees itself. So the finger is just tapping the surface of the part and it can find this step. So this is software that I've been developing for about the last 6 months here to be able to find that and to be able to find that.
Probably half of my job is now essentially coding. I'm doing software development. So we've got our teach pendant on an industrial robot. One of the characteristics of an industrial robot is that they're very easy to use. There's a teach pendant, it's got a little screen on it, which is like Windows screen, Windows based, and then we got some buttons. So it's really easy to use that interface, right? And then we have software running in the background, and the software running in the background, we develop that software so it's easy on the interface to the customer, to the end user, it's really easy. But behind, there's a lot of code running. So I'm always developing that code to make it easier for our customers to grab that pendant and just really easily, quickly learn how to drive the robot. You can learn how to drive the robot, I can teach you in 5 minutes, right? And a lot of that is because of software in the background making that easier.
So here we have one of these teaching pendants, and what I understand is that this is designed for people like me who need to operate this but aren't really engineers or, you know, super ninja robots.
That's right. Yeah, the idea with this is that you can learn how to drive a robot, teach a robot within minutes.
Okay.
I mean, you've got a...
So can I start and stop it?
Yeah, so the robot's in teach right now, but there's a button right here. That's what allows us to have the robot servos turn on, so it's energized. You can adjust the screens here, so you can look at all the different displays. It's all touchscreen. So this is the same data that we have on our normal industrialized pendant, but it's on a nice touchscreen, a lot more information. We can change the graphics and things like that. So here's the buttons we use to drive the robot in the different directions.
Okay.
What's unique about this pendant is you can drive the robot based on, normally we say X, Y, Z, so X is always that direction, Y is always that direction. With this pendant, based on wherever you tell it, you can say go forward, go forward, go forward.
So now if I turn this way,
exactly.
Forward is forward.
Yeah, yeah.
Left is left. And when I turn this way.
So how much easier is that now, right?
That's so much easier. I don't have to know my X, Y, Z axes. Right. And it's not in relationship to where it was. In fact, I can just manage this. And if I'm working and I need to come over here, I can go to the right and it goes to the right. Oh, that's really cool. Yeah, that user interface is super awesome.
My favorite thing to work with is laser sensors. It's an eye for the robot, right? So robots are blind. Robots can't see. They're not aware of their environment. And so we can attach a laser eye to the robot, and now it can see things that it couldn't see before. So now we can have the robot kind of do some magic things, right? So now it can not only see like where the weld seam is, but like what it is. Maybe there's a gap that's opening and closing, right? So we can do like the robot can be smart, can be intelligent. Every time we give it the same part, but the parts are changing a little bit, it can react to that, it can adapt. The one thing I found like in my career is to develop like a niche for yourself. Learn as much as you can about this little field, right? So I'm a welding engineer. There's lots of different welding processes out there, right? I've chosen to focus on a couple different specific welding processes. So some of these I know a little bit about, but I know, you know, more about some things that I've really focused on. But when you become an expert, then that you can have value when you talk to a customer. You know more about that thing that they need help with than you did if you just like a general knowledge of everything, right? So you're more helpful when you kind of develop like a niche understanding of a market.
Wow, what a wonderful job. Wasn't that awesome to see Jack in action working with robots, programming software, and doing all sorts of cool things with metallurgy? Oh, I wonder, could you see yourself in a job like that in the future? So much fun.
So much fun.
But I'm wondering, will you join us for another episode of WunderSTEM? It'll be wonderful.